as an idea, but this focus on the long-term future. So how do we end factory farming over the next century? Not just how do we get some animals out of cages today, and how do we ensure that the moral circle continues to expand after the end of factory farming, and we help wild animals and we don't cause new issues analogous to factory farming?
Greetings, listeners. It's Ruben Blaff here, co-founder and editor at Speakeasy. On today's show, myself and fellow Speakeasy co-founder and editor, Noah Blaff, sit down and chat with the exceptionally interesting Jacy Reese Anthus. Originally from rural Huntsville, Texas, Jacy is a social scientist and co-founder of the Sentience Institute, a think tank centered around how to most effectively expand humanity's moral circle. The Sentience Institute was founded upon an idea that's been Jacy's longtime guiding philosophy in life, effective altruism. People who ascribe to be effective altruists use evidence and reasoning to determine the most effective ways to benefit others. And by others, I mean all sentient beings, not just humans. It was through looking at the world through this lens that Jacy became convinced that his cause X, his way of making the greatest positive impact, was reforming our food system. In 2018, Jacy published his acclaimed book, The End of Animal Farming, summarizing and building upon the Sentience Institute's research. Among other topics, the book deals with the current state of animal farming and the development and popularization of food technologies like plant-based and cell-cultured meat. Jacy's writing has been featured in The Guardian, Vox, Forbes, and other major media outlets. He's presented at conferences and seminars in over 20 countries, and currently, he's a PhD fellow at the University of Chicago. If you enjoy the content and message we're putting out, please consider donating to us either through PayPal for single-time donations or Patreon for monthly contributions. They can be found on our homepage under the Donate tab. They really do make a difference helping support our writers and keep this whole show running. Without further ado, here's our conversation with Jacy Reese Anthus. I was just wondering, I guess maybe to get things kicked off, I've read your book, The End of Animal Farming. I thought it was an incredible book. For those who haven't, I was just wondering maybe if you could give like a brief intro to a bit of your kind of origin story of sorts, maybe kind of a little bit about your upbringing in Texas, maybe how you got involved in effective altruism.
Sure. So the book is the culmination of research into effective animal advocacy. So trying to think about how we can most effectively help animals. And that's motivated by a general project of effective altruism, which is thinking about how we can maximize our project in the world. Personally, I've been a utilitarian since I was 12 years old. So focused on maximizing my own positive impact. You know, that's a more philosophical, abstract, academic school of thought. But effective altruism kind of emerged as people with a variety of philosophical perspectives wanting to go out in the world and put those ideas into practice, you know, maximize the amount of good that they can do. Mm. That's on the issue of, you know, animal farming and factory farming. That's such a big climate issue. And there are over 100 billion, you know, animals suffering in the food system. But it's also issues like global poverty, risk from technology like nuclear war or artificial intelligence. So a range of issues, but all of these, you know, big neglected issues that seem really instrumental for the future of sentient beings. Mm.
So in your book, you talked about how through this effective altruism lens, as you said, there are a number of issues, global issues, that can be viewed through this lens. But for you, you talked about finding this cause X, this thing that mm-hmm. was the most, I guess, maybe neglected, kind of in terms of neglected scale, tractability. Mm-hmm. And for you, at least when you were younger, I'm curious, maybe I'll get back to it later, but for you, that cause X was animal farming, the animal industry. Mm-hmm. And how did you decide on that being your cause X?
Yeah, so I went vegetarian when I was 14. I grew up in a really rural area around a lot of farmed animals. You know, I took care of some goats and chickens when I was a kid and didn't really, I don't know if I was aware of, you know, maybe at some point I had seen an investigation, but I wasn't fully aware until that time. And I read something on the internet, you know, early stages of the internet, wasn't video. It was just like a bullet point list of, you know, a chicken lives on a piece of printing paper. Their beaks are cut off, and these sort of facts about them. And that was very clear that, you know, from my own diet perspective, that, you know, the enjoyment I got from consuming meat wasn't worth the suffering it was causing to those animals. And so that's a relatively simple moral calculus in my own situation. Some people's are more complicated. They have certain health conditions. They have to, you know, have some more complex considerations. But when I was doing my bachelor's, so I studied neuroscience, and as I was getting to the end of that, I knew that, you know, entering the workforce, I would need to be more settled on a specific area. I audited a graduate philosophy course with a man named Michael Tye at the University of Texas, who was talking about the case for non-human animal consciousness. And I couldn't find a argument, you know, a plausible argument that would mean humans are either the sole, you know, holders of sentience in the natural world, or have so much more sentience and consciousness and this capacity for suffering and happiness than other entities. You know, all the arguments were either, well, you know, chickens have a good portion of it, but not all of it, or chickens have all of it. There wasn't really any case I could make for focusing on human issues from that perspective. So I really just put that into kind of a spreadsheet, you know, both literally and metaphorically in terms of my own calculus of what I should focus on. And the most cost-effective thing for me to do was to focus on factory farming as an issue, and in particular, the sort of long-termist approach, which has taken off a lot more in recent years as an idea, but this focus on the long-term future. So how do we end factory farming over the next century? Not just how do we get some animals out of cages today, and how do we ensure that the moral circle continues to expand after the end of factory farming, and we help wild animals, and we don't cause new issues analogous to factory farming? What about the rights of robots and artificial sentience that could emerge one day? It gets quite speculative, obviously, but having that long-term view ended up being the approach I wanted to take with my cause X.
That is really cool. And speaking about sentience, from that kind of, I guess, your work or your ascribing to that effect of altruists lifestyle and your growing up around animals, you actually formed an institute, the Sentience Institute. And for those who don't know what the Sentience Institute is, I'm wondering if you could maybe give us a brief Sparks Notes about what the Institute is about.
Sure. So we were founded in 2017. We started the project in 2016 to study the expansion of humanity's moral circle. So I alluded to this more abstract philosophical project behind addressing animal suffering and behind a lot of human issues too, you know, extending concern beyond our own nations and kind of less so the age of nationalism, more so the age of globalism, or with other issues like how do we consider wild animals and the environment and do we expand our moral circle to include them? There's this underlying arc of history that seems important, and there was no organization explicitly focusing on it. So there are organizations, you know, I worked with animal charity evaluators a lot, which I recommend to people if they're interested in maybe donating, you know, around the holiday season to animal charities trying to make a dent in factory farming. They recommend some really cost-effective groups working towards that and other related goals. But Sentience Institute wanted to embark on this more long-term project. So we have done historical case studies, for example, of, you know, in the 1600s and 1700s, how did the UK abolish the slave trade and eventually slavery in the British Empire, which, you know, kicked off what we think of now as these modern rights movements. So what was it that allowed them to sort of break through their moral blinders that they had at the time, where they weren't considering, you know, even other human beings as persons? They were instead seen as legal property. Mm-hmm. And that conversation has obviously built up a lot more in the past few hundred years and led to other movements that we study, some of which are really interesting. Like, we actually did a case study on anti-abortion. And this is interesting, not because it's the same sort of cause, you know, it's on the other end of the political spectrum, but it is in some sense trying to expand the moral circle to include unborn fetuses. Mm. So they've endured a lot of the same social dynamics of trying to bring a new entity into humanity's moral circle with varying degrees of success. But we do that sort of abstract big picture case study. And then we run surveys. You know, we did the first large survey of U.S. attitudes towards animal farming and animal-free food. We found that 47% of U.S. adults say they support a ban on slaughterhouses, which is a really huge figure when you contrast it with the 5, 6, 7% of people who are vegetarian in the U.S. Mm-hmm. And this indicates a emergence of institutional values, where people oppose the institution of factory farming and want to see change in that regard, but won't change their own behavior. I think this has a lot of applications to various environmental and social and human rights issues, where we can't expect people to really change one by one very powerfully. It doesn't make a big impact in society. It's not a route to success for social movements. But fighting for policy and fighting for institutions, at least as the end game, is almost always more promising.
That's very interesting. In terms of factory farming and your book, for those people out there who don't really know much about factory farming, they've maybe heard, they've had things lobbed at them by animal activists or vegans saying, shouldn't be eating meat. But for those who don't know kind of maybe the ins and outs of animal farming and the industry, what would you say is some important things that they should know about the practice?
Yeah, if people want to read or watch more, so Mercy for Animals conducts a lot of undercover investigations, and I like to recommend that people just go to their website. I think it's mercyforanimals.com/investigations, and just pick a random video because they're all horrific, and each will show you a different aspect of what's going on these farms. If you're interested in the more technical, you know, how many animals are in what amount of space, so what is their life like in terms of confinement, the Humane Society of the United States has a lot of great white papers that you can find on their website detailing just pages and pages of citations with the various conditions that those animals endure. But to share some, you know, specifics, so chickens are raised in extremely large numbers. They're small animals compared to a cow or a pig, so you need a lot of them. They get in very small spaces. You know, often, like I said, with my own journey, they are not in more than a sheet of printer paper. And if they're being raised for eggs, they're confined in very small cages with each other, either these battery cages, which are extremely tiny, or colony cages, which are larger but have more birds. They live their entire life on wires. You know, their feet get long-term injuries from that because they're not built to kind of walk around on a wire all day. They go kind of crazy. You know, it's almost insanity that happens on these farms. In many cases, it probably is from that boredom. So they'll start pecking at each other, for example, the way that they would normally all day peck at the ground and dig for grubs and things in food, you know, forage. They can't really fly around. So that's another inhibition of natural behavior. And then genetically, you know, if they're being raised for eggs, they're laying over 300 jumbo-sized eggs every year, which is far beyond the 15, 20, maybe 30 that red jungle fowl, the chicken's natural ancestor, would be laying during, you know, one season of the year. And the eggs are much larger, really wreaks havoc on the reproductive system. My wife and I adopted two egg-laying hens from a battery cage farm in California, and we actually put them on implants. So similar to the hormonal implants humans use as birth control, these inhibit their egg production and give them much longer, you know, happier, healthier lives. But without that, even if you had them on a free-range farm, they'd still be suffering a lot just because of how they're bred. And similarly, chickens raised for meat grow so much meat that they often collapse under their own weight. They have heart attacks, organ failure, because they're just not genetically built to grow that much. And that's why they have to be slaughtered at a young age, because they just can't survive at that point. And that's kind of when you reap the highest economic return. Mm-hmm. So that's just one subset of factory farming. You know, you can look into cows, you can look into pigs. A lot of people have some identification with, you know, a certain farmed animal who touches them personally. And then fish is a huge issue, both environmentally and then just, you know, those animals are even smaller and we've given less consideration to their welfare. So the conditions they live in are often much worse than even chickens.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just had a question, which is going back to the utilitarian aspect of effective altruism and the approaches taken. Is there a distinction made between a quantitative distinction made between the suffering of certain factory farming animals in terms of the priority we place on, say, policy, like you were saying, aimed at the chicken farming versus cows or other animals?
Yeah, that's a really interesting point, where how do we actually measure the difference in sentience or the difference in consciousness between any two entities, but in particular, these different farmed animals. You know, a chicken in some ways seems simpler than a pig or a cow, just in terms of the size of their brain, you could say. But how much of that is just driven by the fact that a cow needs a lot of neurons to operate this large hulking body, and then a chicken doesn't need so much? We don't see really any solid behavioral indicators that pigs, cows, chickens, or even, you know, most species of fish. It gets different if you consider shellfish, like oysters. But they seem to be in the same ballpark of sentience. They can do similar things. They have similar behaviors. And then from our really rough, you know, early stage neuroscience understanding of their brain, they have some of the same sort of brain structures. That being said, there have been more studies of pigs in particular. So studies, for example, where they can recognize their name. You know, you can have a large group, assign them names, call them in to eat, and one at a time. There are some viral videos of, you know, dogs being called in this way, and it's very cute. It's unclear whether that's because pigs have just been studied more, or whether that's a capacity that you know, cows and chickens don't have. So I'd say overall, they're in the same ballpark of sentience, which means the dominant utilitarian consideration is the number of calories and the treatment of each animal. So the fact that it takes around 200 chickens to produce the same number of calories as a cow means that chickens are a much more important, you know, cause area. And they happen to be treated worse, in part because they're birds, in part because they're small, and in part because just the practicalities of managing that many feathered animals, for example, in a slaughterhouse, you know, is really challenging. And the few animal welfare laws that exist around the world today that apply to farmed animals usually just apply to mammals, to cows and pigs. For example, some countries use stun guns to kill them, which are, you know, a quicker way to die than many of the ways these animals are slaughtered.
Yeah. I also had a question, I guess, going back to your path, looking back, and that course that you took, the graduate course on consciousness. Would you say that is the biggest catalyst that kind of drove you to where you're at today? Are there other influential literary things, maybe Peter Singer, or anything you've read that kind of sparked your desire to pursue what you've pursued more so than that class?
Yeah, I mean, I grew up on the internet in these early stages of the movement. So I was reading like, you know, MySpace or her Facebook posts and email listservs content. Brian Tomasik has a wonderful blog where he writes a lot of essays on issues like factory farming, but especially like wild animal suffering and these more kind of deep end, harder to grapple with issues. So it's important to lay them out intellectually. So that was definitely something I was reading at the time. Now there are books on, you know, there are several books now on effective altruism. Will McCaskill's book, Peter Singer's book. Those weren't around at that time, so they weren't very influential to me personally. But if I were reading them today, I think they would be. So yeah, there aren't that many like big books or documentaries or anything like that. Like I said, the reason I went vegetarian was like, I don't even remember the website. It was just like a bullet point list, you know, in plain text of the things that these animals were going through. But there's a really nice community today and a lot more literature that people can learn from. I would say that when I, you know, was a utilitarian as a kid and then discovered that utilitarianism was a thing, discovered that for hundreds of years philosophers have been writing about it, that was, you know, one of the best days of my life and one of the most illuminating days where I was able to start reading the work of, you know, Jeremy Bentham and John Stuart Mill and these other folks.
Yeah, that's incredible. I just wanted to maybe bring it back to a moment to your book, to The End of Animal Farming. And I guess when you talk about the book, you kind of described it as sort of a roadmap to kind of getting us from where we are today, kind of in terms of a kind of the farmed animal movement, to where you could see us in the future. And I was just wondering if you could maybe just touch on kind of, in your mind, what are kind of the main milestones along that roadmap, and maybe what is the final destination maybe in your in your mind of along this roadmap, to stick with that analogy?
Yeah, I've mainly conceptualized it as four quarters of the century and what's happening right now from 2000, which we could consider roughly the beginning of this farmed animal movement, to 2025. And I think a lot of that's laying foundation, both social foundation, so these undercover investigations, awareness of the cruelty that's happening, a more infrastructural foundation, like these groups like Mercy for Animals and the Humane League, getting, you know, millions of dollars in revenue, forming connections with politicians and journalists, and these capacities. And then the technology technology. I have been increasingly convinced that technology is going to be the way forward. So right now there's a lot of research happening into plant-based, you know, beef burgers, for example, like the Impossible Burger and the Beyond Burger. They're a little expensive now. You know, we still need to bring the prices down, get economies of scale going. That's another way of laying foundation. And then this cultured meat, so making real meat from animal cells grown outside of an animal's body. The world's first, you know, cultured hamburger was in 2013. And then just in this past week, there was the world's first ribeye steak made by Aleph in Israel, which is wonderful. So that's happening up until 2025, roughly. We're just laying foundation. I don't expect like a big displacement of, you know, Burger King switches all of their Whoppers to the Impossible Whopper. But once you have that foundation, I think from 2025 to 2050, that's when we're going to start seeing feedback loops. And, you know, once plant-based meat reaches price parity, that's going to be huge, because then you no longer have this premium, this, it's a luxury item. It's an option on the menu for people who want to opt into it. And restaurants will be able to say, okay, we actually want to switch our main patty to a plant-based version that most people, you know, they don't care. They eat what's most convenient and what's in front of them. If it tastes the same, if it's better for you, you know, they'll switch into it. And the reason they don't now is because it is more expensive, or because, you know, in some areas the taste and texture isn't quite right, because just the technology is still developing. You'll see that as a feedback loop. So as more people eat it, the price will go down further. This is a very virtuous cycle. Also, we've seen these welfare reforms. So this like policy change where the farmed animal movement is starting to pass laws for cage-free eggs, for example, which is building that infrastructural momentum as politicians and government officials understand that this is an important issue for voters. You know, now Cory Booker and some other senators are pushing for a moratorium on large factory farms by 2040. And that feeds into the vegetarianism and the plant-based foods, which then feeds into the welfare reforms and so on and so forth. So I would say the big like thing to look forward to is when these cycles really hit their stride, and we see those big changes happening, not just for these early adopters and these innovators, as if you've seen this diffusion of innovations curve that social scientists like, but they start reaching the early majority of the broader population who really needs it to be around the same price to switch to these new products.
Yeah, I was curious, for someone, I don't know the differences in Canada and US, but if you could potentially comment for someone who doesn't know on what are the kind of choke points, or what's stopping the policy from the internal US government? So things like the Department of Agriculture, the incentives they have to either continue on with their practices, or what the costs of switching would be for them.
Yeah, there are a lot of dimensions here. With the USDA, they have a dual mandate. So one mandate is to consumers and to the general health of the food system. But they also have a mandate to help agricultural producers. And that means whoever the agricultural producers are at the time, which unfortunately right now includes a lot of factory farming. So they've been quite resistant to positive change in that regard, because just their literal job is to defend the status quo. In the federal government more broadly, it depends on the institution. You know, the FDA has a singular mandate for consumer safety, and they're able to be more open to these. So that's why when these cultured meat products were first, you know, we were deciding who's going to regulate them, there was a big focus on trying to get the FDA to do it, because the industry, the animal advocates and the new food technology companies thought that they'd be more friendly. So you can go through some departments. In general, the U.S. federal political landscape is very gridlocked. It's you know, everyone likes to watch it. It's a big reality TV show, essentially. But we have this two-party system and this issue where, especially for fringe topics, so the things that aren't healthcare, the economy, gun control, these number one talking points for both parties, it's just really hard to get anything through the legislature. My hope and my expectation is that the route to success for the farmed animal movement is as kind of a bipartisan side issue. I don't want it to become the number one talking point, because then one party is going to be against it and the other party is going to be for it. Unless we fix these kind of fundamental dynamics by then, that's probably going to turn it into something similar to climate change legislation, where just the Democrats aren't able to push it through the Republican, you know, block that exists, even when Democrats have, you know, mostly control of our two houses, our two congressional houses and the presidency. I think Canada and especially Europe have more flexibility here. There's just less gridlock in general. They're more open to these fringe issues. And then just it can fall under the umbrella of climate issues, which means that countries who have a more climate-friendly policy in general you know, this is the kind of environmental elephant in the room, the 14% of greenhouse gas emissions that's coming from animal agriculture. So I think they'll have more luck with it, and they're starting to. I mean, the UK is in an active discussion of a meat tax right now. Some other countries have considered it. We'll see how that goes. It's still really tricky. They still have an animal agriculture industry that's going to lobby against it, but I'm more optimistic. In the US, I think it mostly just has to be technology, corporate, and eventually kind of a side channel of political change.
That's very interesting. I was also wondering if it's a very speculative thing, but part of your book also does, you don't shy away from speculation. If you were looking right now at plant-based alternatives and cultured or clean meat alternatives, and you were putting on your prognosticator hat and saying it's going to be plant-based that gets us to where we need to go, or it's going to be cultured, or it's going to be some combination of both, I'm wondering where you would land on that.
Yeah, certainly a combination, though that's kind of the cop-out answer. Yeah. But if I had to pick one, it would be the cultured meat. In fact, I conceptualize the Impossible Burger and similar products right now as establishing to the public that, you know, an animal product doesn't have to be the center of your plate. That's been a big fight, you know, actually. It didn't used to be that way when incomes were lower and, you know, most people in the 1800s, you know, couldn't afford meat at the center of their plate at least every day. And then the animal agriculture industry cemented this with, like, we have these slogans, beef, it's what's for dinner, the incredible edible egg, got milk, and so on. That really put animal products in the center of the standard American diet, the so-called SAD diet, which has led to a lot of our health issues as well. Though I'm less convinced of the nutritional arguments against animal products, but that's another discussion. But I think that now we're wrestling away from that conception, and that's what plant-based products are doing. They're paving the way for these cultured products that are going to come along. Mm. Part of this is just optimism. You know, there's a question of, in theory, cultured meat should be able to get price parity pretty easily. Like, what we're doing is all the things that a cow or a chicken does inside their body to produce muscle and fat tissue, without all the other things that those animals do, produce beaks and feathers and brains and walk around and all these things. So I buy that theoretical argument. There's a more practical argument, which is, even if that is in theory possible, is there some roadblock that we'll hit that will just keep it from getting quite down to price parity until we get just full biological control over human and animal bodies? So, for example, the immune system. You know, it might be really tough to keep these animal cultures. Sorry, just a minute. Apollo, come here. One of my dogs is eating trying to eat the food of another dog. Apollo, come here. he knows when I'm distracted, and we'll start.
He's caught on to the when you're not paying attention, he can get in there.
Exactly. So anyway, to go back briefly, cultured products can in theory be cheaper than animal products because you're not doing all the other things an animal does. But if there's some fundamental roadblock there, like the immune system, where we're not able to have a sanitary kind of production facility, it's just really hard. We have to, like, use antibiotics, which is kind of one of the big reasons people want to move away from factory farming. Mm-hmm. What if we end up having to do that same thing in the cultured meat setting? The public and regulators and the producers themselves might not be very happy with that. And can we really build, like, an artificial immune system? Probably not. That's just one of the hardest things to do in terms of synthetic biology. Right now, I think that we'll be able to overcome this. For example, we can select cell cultures that aren't going to be ridden with these diseases, and we can keep the facility sanitary the same way we do with biomedical facilities. That makes it a little more expensive, but I don't think prohibitively so. But depending on these, there could be some roadblock that keeps cultured meat from being the main conduit, in which case I do think it will be plant-based products. I still think just there's going to be environmental catastrophe. There's going to be an expanding moral circle. That means we include animals more so and want to move past factory farming. And at that point, I'm you know, cautiously optimistic that we'll still get there, even if there's some large technical hurdle.
You made a very prescient point just a couple minutes back about the marketing efficacy of animal products and how they've kind of developed this campaign for having it in your diet as the staples that we now know in the standard American diet. Do you see something similar being needed or just happening with plant-based diets in the future, where the marketing becomes so persuasive and so, you know, effective that people are thinking about it in the same terms as what we now think of got milk, you know, all the examples you just gave?
Yeah, there's some question of, like, do we use the same black magic that the animal agriculture industry has used to fight against them. I think this is somewhat true. You know, I think marketing is important. There are lots of cultured meat advocates like me who will say, no, it's just going to be such a great product that it doesn't matter how it's marketed. It doesn't matter what we call it. People are still going to switch to it. I'm not quite that optimistic. You know, I think that if it's called lab grown meat on a package, which I think is very unlikely, you know, meat, in fact, isn't even labeled meat on the package. It's something more specific like beef or hamburgers or something. Mm-hmm. So I don't think we'll have that issue. But if it were, I think that would put a lot of people off. I think we could see a PR issue, you know, that leads to a 10-year delay in adoption, for example. Like if, as I was saying, there's some, you know, food poisoning issue and these facilities aren't kept sanitary, you know, one of the first commercial sales ends up having an E. coli outbreak. That would be really, really, or sorry, E. coli outbreak. That'd be really terrible. So I think we need to focus on, you know, a baseline of marketing, which is things like calling it cultured meat, things like having it labeled honestly on the package as burgers, as sausages, or as whatever specific product it truly is, down to the molecular level. I'm not as worried about, like, do we have a catchy slogan and these kind of more ambitious goals. I don't know if we need those. I think the main pitch of this product is going to be more simple. It's going to be more similar to like health food, you know, how that's kind of taken off without much of a, you know, catchy jingle to go alongside it. When we do get these, you know, mass market items, for example, I think Go-Gurt, this like drinkable yogurt that I know I had a lot as a kid, as like that gets a vegan version or switches to an entirely plant-based formula, you know, they might have a new jingle for it to show it off to people. But in large part, it'll be the similar kind of campaigning you see for specific brands rather than for the product itself. Because in some way, we don't want to reject Got Milk as a slogan. We just want to change the parenthetical in their cow-based milk to now plant-based milk.
Mm. Yeah, in fact, some of the marketing will likely be coming from these big companies that are adopting it for business model sakes and profitability sakes, as we've already been seeing, you know, companies like fast food chains getting into it, and they'll have their own, you know, big marketing campaigns that will, I guess, deal with that.
Exactly. I think that the end game for Memphis Meats and Just and some of these other companies is largely to partner with these existing food companies who have these large distribution channels and just replace that part of their supply chain. Instead of getting meat from the slaughterhouse or meat processing facility, they get meat from Memphis Meats, or they just take the technology and then kind of license it and build it up together with them as a kind of intellectual, you know, flank of the broader food company itself.
Mm, yeah. That's really interesting. I don't want to take up too much of your time, but I just had a few questions more.
Sure.
One question I was wondering about was, has there been a major effect that the coronavirus has had on this issue of animal farming, on the issue of kind of the food that we eat, the way that it's produced? And I was wondering if maybe you could comment on that.
Yeah, I don't know if it's had as big of an effect as some people would hope, you know, hoping that it's a wake-up call to the issues in the food system, both in terms of, you know, factory farming's contribution to pandemic risk. I mean, the COVID, the story behind it, the best guess, you know, scientists have is that it wasn't through factory farming. It was from horseshoe bats going into penguins who are used in food and medicine in some parts of China. So it was maybe an agricultural story in some sense, but it wasn't factory farming. There were no pigs or chickens or cows involved or fish. But I think there is some awareness of that happening. There's certainly, you know, in newspaper articles, for example, we see media covering at times, you know, not that much of it, the contribution of factory farming to pandemic risk. There have been some big books, you know, that talk about pandemics in general and mention factory farming as one of the issues. And then the other perhaps bigger thing is meat processing facilities and the workers, the conditions, the fact that they are quite unsafe, you know, working there in close quarters and unsanitary conditions for many hours a day. Many of them are undocumented immigrants in the U.S. Who are more susceptible to health issues in general and would face worse health consequences if they do contract a virus of some sort. But I think in general, we're right now at the point where we've somewhat gotten over, or at least gotten to the end game of coronavirus, and are starting to have more conversations about, does this become a lasting, you know, policy change? Mm-hmm. I know in the U.S. some activist groups are trying to push for this specifically, trying to unite the animal welfare groups and the workers' rights groups, especially immigrant workers' rights groups, together to say we need to fundamentally change the conditions in which these slaughterhouses operate, or that we need to fine or otherwise sanction these companies that have been causing these negative health outcomes. So we'll see how that pans out. It hasn't panned out that much yet. I know a lot of people were more hopeful. You know, there have been tests, for example, studies within the animal welfare movement of, if we focus on coronavirus and make the connection to animal farming, how does that affect people's attitudes? Is that now a more effective way to get people to go vegetarian than the old way of focusing on the environment or animal welfare? Those have had mixed results. You know, some people get resistant to it. You know, they say, like, maybe they have their own political views in the U.S. where they think coronavirus is some sort of hoax or exaggerated, or have like negative connotations around the focus on it. Maybe they just don't believe it. You know, they think, oh, these animal rights people are just trying to say everything is caused by animal cruelty. So I don't think that's been, you know, widely adopted at this point. It's certainly something the organizations and advocates are posting some about on social media. But we'll see. You know, I think overall it is a bit of a wake-up call in a more existential sense for humanity. I've got a paper in some mission right now that talks about this general notion of a risk society. So this notion of in the current age, we're facing these global threats. You know, it's no longer wars between global superpowers and you pick a side and you fight against each other. Now the enemy is a more global thing, like a virus or a climate change. And we need a different social sense of battle and of war and of success as a species. Mm. And I think we might see that more general shift. That'll, of course, be more of an undercurrent and less explicit. But some of that could be very good in terms of tackling these important issues.
That's really cool. That's really interesting. I was also wondering, in the last couple of questions I have, one of the claims that you make in the book, or a prognostication rather, is again that you kind of foresee that by around 2100, that was kind of a ballpark estimate that you had said, that kind of by then, kind of the forms of farming that we have right now, animal farming, will kind of be like outdated, kind of seem like archaic things of the past. Are you still bullish on that claim?
Yeah, it's still my best guess. I think the one thing The couple updates I've had, one has been I expected the first commercial sale earlier. So it just happened. It was in Singapore. A company called Just served some kids. You know, I'm sure their meal was paid for, but technically sold them some cultured meat, which is wonderful. I expected a company to do that earlier because then they get publicity and then they get established as the first company to commercially sell cultured meat. I think part of the reason I was wrong there was more of just every company that really needed it was getting investment. The hard battles to be fought were in the R&D lab, and they didn't really need that sort of publicity, or at least it wasn't the focus of the companies. But nonetheless, that has happened just a year or two later than I expected. So that's updated me a little downwards. The coronavirus in general, I think, is a positive update in this sense. Again, a negative phenomenon, but I think it is that sort of wake-up call. It's a shot across the bow for climate change and other issues, and now I expect progress in those areas a little more quickly. Trump is out of office. That's another consideration. So there's this broad social dynamic where, like I said, the U.S. government gets very focused on a few issues and fringe issues get kind of tossed out. I think this happens globally, and just the more humans are preoccupied with something like Trump or the rise of, you know, populism or nationalism in some specific country, the less that they're focused on these environmental and animal goals that sometimes get put to the side in those situations. But now that he's out of office, I'm more optimistic that we'll move past those issues as a society. In general, I do think that, you know, 2100 makes sense when you look at the timelines of past social movements and technological changes. You know, the way I sort of came up with that, though, again, it's not a precise process, it is a prognostication, is looking at like personal computers and how did they take off, pasteurization of milk and other agricultural technologies, GMOs, to what extent did they take off, how long did it take them, and how are these rates of change also changing over time? Like cell phones, for example, were very very quickly adopted, more quickly than personal computers, because now we have a faster distribution of innovation in society at large. But if we look back at, you know, human rights issues, and if we think of the end of factory farming as purely kind of an animal rights issue, that can get you a pretty slow timeline, because it took centuries, you know, for anti-slavery advocates to end slavery. And even then, that was just one project in the overall, you could say, anti-racism project that activists are still embarking on today. So some of these kind of human rights timelines take longer. Animal rights, you know, other contexts of helping dogs and cats in our homes and in shelters, or animals used in laboratories for cosmetics and biomedical research, you know, those movements are taking a long time to see success. So if you kind of concoct these in your own weighted average, I think you can get something as early as you know, 2050, a lot of people are optimistic, or as late as, you know, 2200 or something. And then finally, not to go on too long, but the last consideration is big, you know, kind of the next industrial revolution kind of changes. So I do think artificial intelligence is going to create really big changes in society around that same time, maybe the end of the century. So if we see this sort of technological singularity, then if we have artificial intelligence, if we expand to other planets, like, we're not going to bring factory farming along with us. It's a very, again, inefficient process. And that artificial intelligence will be able to do something like solve those technical hurdles that we talked about in Culture Meat. So that makes me more optimistic. You know, who knows what the world will look like, but I don't think factory farming will exist. Or maybe humans will just go extinct, in which case factory farming won't exist.
That's a very interesting point about when you talk about AI and the inefficiency of factory farming, something I hadn't considered. Is animal farming, I guess, more broadly speaking about, I guess, you and your work with the Sentience Institute, is animal farming still your cause X?
Well, it's never been just animal farming. Again, it's been this long-termist moral circle expansion effective animal advocacy project. You know, and I had a small blog when I was starting to write to think about these issues in 2013 and 2014. And I made this case for value spreading, as it was called. More so, moral circle expansion has kind of been a newer name. And that is still my cause X. You know, I've been in this long-termist direction. I haven't had big updates. You know, this is kind of one of these questions. Should we be focused as effective altruists on just prioritizing better in general, figuring out which of these issues we should be focused on? And I think we do grab low-hanging fruit, and then there are now greatly decreasing returns to at least that broad kind of armchair speculation. I think if we're diving into the details and doing something like, okay, let's try working on global poverty. Let's see how effective our efforts are. Let's try, you know, doing technical research on artificial intelligence architectures to better build safe artificial intelligence in the future. That can still reap a lot of information value, but it's no longer for me that broad speculation that I was doing, you know, circa 2010 to 2014.
And I guess one last question before we sign
Apollo.
Off.
Come here.
With Valentine's Apollo. Day just around the corner, I was wondering.
No.
You work alongside your wife, which is an interesting dynamic that I don't think a lot of people actually experience. And I was wondering if you could maybe to kind of send us off, maybe just, I don't know, give us an insight or talk a little bit about what is it like working with your significant other and kind of what is that experience like for people who never get to experience it?
Yeah, my wife and I met at the intersection of animal advocacy and effective altruism. I was coming in as quite a skeptic. You know, she was working with a group called Direct Action Everywhere, which does these more confrontational grassroots protests to work on animal rights. And I was coming in saying, like, is that really effective? Why do you think this is the best way to help animals? We were almost arguing and debating at that point. We got married last year, and the New York Times covered us, and I think their title was something like, "In love, at least there's no debate." So we had that seed of our relationship that was from our intellectual and professional interests. And I think we stuck with that. You know, I think even if people don't have that overlap in workplace or specifically side by side being with their partner, you know, we co-founded this organization and worked together on it for 3 years. I think they can still have a passion for each other's passions and be genuinely interested in whatever excites that person. And I think going out of your way to do this, I think we have more control over our own interests than we think we do, cultivating an excitement in whatever they're into. And if that's something very different, you know, I don't know, I don't spend much time thinking about human health and healthcare and nursing or being a doctor. But if I was married to somebody in those categories, I would try to look up articles on the weekend and get a sense of it. And I think sharing some of that passion, even if it's just a little bit of conversation over dinner, is really important. Being able to engage in that way. You know, I love having someone who I can talk to about the possibility of artificial sentience suffering 1,000 years in the future and what morally that means for how we should fight for human and animal rights today. And that is a very special part of a relationship that I think many people get, and I think they don't deliberately pursue and think about as much as they could.
Thank you for listening to this week's Speakeasy podcast. We'd like to thank Jacy again for taking the time to chat with us. We're sure he'll join us again in the future, so stay tuned for new appearances. Also, if you found our chat with Jacy interesting, you might want to check out my article series on his incredible book, The End of Animal Farming. You can find the first installment of the deep dive up on the website now. Again, if you haven't already, please like, subscribe, and follow us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever you find yourself listening. If you enjoy the content and message we're putting out, please consider donating to us, either through PayPal for single-time donations, or Patreon for monthly contributions. They can be found on our homepage under the Donate tab. Thanks again, and remember to speak easy and speak free.